Folks, as we get ready for this one, it is going to be a good one. DeSoto comes in averaging 63 points a game. Zy Creek comes in 76 points per game, 33 given up, and 32-0.
Zy Creek is one of the most hyped up teams in the entire country.
Going into the first quarter of the state game, I wasn't really nervous because I felt like, you know, with a team like that, they were used to coming out pretty fast. So we just had to let them have their run, but we knew what we had. So I felt like we weren't really nervous. It just took us a little longer.
You do not want to play from behind when facing two McDonald's All-Americans.
My mindset after the first quarter, it was like, we can't play no worse than this, you know. We just had to get all the little jitters out, you know. We haven't been back, and it was our first time back in 2 years, so we just like, get all the jitters out, it's okay. I still had confidence in us because we've been down before, and it wasn't our first time. So it was like, hey, we got punched in the face, so either we're going to keep getting punched or we got to punch them back. So.
During that game, when we got behind, I want to say it was double digits, you know, my first thought was, if we do not hurry up and get a bucket, this game is about to get out of control. For me, this season, if I could describe it in one word, would be difficult, very challenging. Get there, be strong. Get there, elbows up. Malaysia, can you not get there in one dribble? Do it. You don't have time for that extra dribble. When I was a young head coach, I always just remember DeSoto, and I just always remember their players, and they were always known to have these phenomenal guards and athletes. So I always watch DeSoto and just really just been impressed with the kids and how much talent was over here. And so I knew coming in, this definitely was a place of potential. It was a place of greatness. Definitely knew that. I mean, I just believe this city has greatness all over it. I think you just have to get in and just kind of find the right ingredient to birth it. But no, I always knew that DeSoto could be great. But coming, when we came in from Guyer, I don't think we knew that what was coming up the pipeline until I was able to get over there at that middle school and then kind of talk with people in the community. Because one thing about this community, everybody talks, everybody knows who's what, what's coming up the line. And so I was able to get out to the middle schools and found out that we just had a little bit of greatness at every middle school. And then I found out about this class. I think they were sixth graders at the time. Mm-hmm. This group of kids that was supposed to be phenomenal. But yeah, we came at the right time. And so Krill and I talked. And then by the time she got over here, she began to hit the streets and investigate and tag the community and find out what was going on.
As the department chair, he's still going. Oh man, I did a good job on your office, didn't I? Cleaning it up. Good morning. It's our security team. Now these two of our best security officers right here. I know this is clean. That's where Airmark will be, and the main cafeteria is clean. Chartwell's got it, so Chartwell's going to cook in there. But Tahir has to cook in there, and I know we ain't gonna eat unless they come clean it. They'll lose. They'll be third automatically. When they walk in, we be like, no, we're not eating that. So we ask Mr. Lester, come over here and get somebody in here real quick.
Day one here, you know, there are two groups that readily embraced my arrival and were excited about me coming. One was football, and then there was girls basketball.
You so serious? Like, they already got it planned?
Like, 25.
25.
See, this is like 5:30. Yeah. I have to wake up at like 5 o'clock.
Right. I don't get dressed.
I don't even go to sleep till 12 o'clock.
People don't know this. Like, they don't understand this. Is that those girls are high academic achieving girls and they're student athletes. People don't know that. And it's like, well, you know, you can't just cater to athletics. No, you're kind of an academic. Academically, they're matching up with anybody in this building. That's why the class of 2021 salutatorian is our guard, our starting guard.
I'm gonna be on the field, right?
You're gonna be right.
You're gonna be on the stage talking.
They've got to do it in Spain, so.
I mean, they come down in a group, and it was always, you know, a chat. They want to talk things through. At lunchtime, they come in the cafeteria. They would all sit as a group, and then where I may be drifting around the cafeteria, if I'm drifting and haven't drifted over there, they're the ones that came and got me and said, hey, come to the table. And so it really left an impression upon me.
Well, when it first hit, it was very hard on us. Actually, it was hard on us throughout the whole process. I want to say that. I want to say kudos to all our kids that are in athletics here, because it wasn't easy. All the parents that did a tremendous job in supporting us and trusting us with their kids to get through this process right here, which was the COVID-19 virus. It was difficult. It was very difficult. It was difficult in all sports.
Our students had to be extremely resilient in regards to COVID. Our student athletes, many of them, at least 99% of them, were not in-person learners, which meant they were on the Zoom calls, they were completing assignments outside of regular school day, and at the same time, they had commitments at school. So they had to come to school for practice. One of the best things I think we implemented early, we were able to watch our volleyball team do it, our football team, and then our basketball team really perfected it, was having students after practice assemble and go through class together.
So I have to drive extra safe since you're in here now.
Yeah.
I'm not saying I'm not a good driver. I thought my senior year was gonna be like fun and I'm outside, you know? Like, we having all types of activities, because usually seniors, they doing activities and having fun and pep rallies and all that type of stuff. We gotta be at home most of the time. And online learning is just, I like it. I actually like it better because I can eat breakfast when I want to and just.
What's your favorite thing to eat for breakfast?
Like going out to a restaurant. I like French toast and eggs and sausage. French toast is better than pancakes, by the way. I just eat like oatmeal, sausage, that's the quickest thing, or a breakfast sandwich. My best subject would be English, but I don't really have a favorite. And I just think English is my best because my mom was an English teacher, so I was into that more. So yeah, sometimes we come in here after practice and log in to Zoom and do our work and listen to the teacher talk.
The ability and the potential for DeSoto is unlimited. Unlimited. So, do you want to talk about the Mr. Billingsley Dream House? You always
Mr. Blanding's dream house.
Is it Mr.?
Yeah. I used to say it's Mr. Blanding.
Blanding. Oh, who is Billingsley?
I used to say it wrong.
Oh.
So like this.
She tells me about this all the time. I've got to watch it. Have you ever seen that?
So this is like a 1950s, Cary Grant movie. So it's an old black and white film, and I saw this movie maybe like right as we were coming to DeSoto, and I was at actually one of our, so one thing that, you know, we kind of have here, we've always been blessed with great spiritual covering.
Absolutely.
We always have just pastors that come, that pour into us as coaches, they pour into our kids.
Yeah.
You know, we have people that just are steadfast in prayer, everything we do. So, you know, we do believe in the prophetic.
Absolutely.
And I'm watching this movie, Mr. Blanding's Dream House, and it's an old Cary Grant movie, and it starts where he's like an advertising executive. He's living in New York. Him and his wife, they're in like this overcrowded apartment. They have like 5 or 6 kids, and like the beginning of the movie, it's just, you know, they're all on top of each other fighting over a bathroom. Like it's obvious that the messaging is there's not enough space in this apartment. Like, we got to get out. And, you know, at first, you know, his wife is, they're like, well, can we remodel or can we just renovate and let's redecorate? And, you know, they kind of go through the thing of like, you can change, you can redecorate, renovate, do all you want to, but there's just not enough space. So he's at work one day and he kind of learns that in Connecticut, they are selling these houses and there's all this land. So he's like, hey, let's move to Connecticut and I can just take this train to work every day.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
they get,
I take the train.
So they take, they go to, him and his family, they go to Connecticut with this real estate agent, and they see this house with this beautiful lot. And they're just, when they drive up to it, they can't see it as it is. They see it as it can become.
Yeah.
And they purchase this house. And the real estate agent at the time, he's like, man, like, let me hurry up and get him to sign this paper. Because he knew that there were problems with the house.
Yeah.
So they buy the house, they buy the lot. And he's trying to just cover it with paint and just fix the stuff up. And it's, you know, you open the door falls off.
Yes, it does.
You know, the plumbing doesn't work. The electricity is shoddy. I mean, there's so many issues with the house to where they finally just have a land surveyor come out and he looks at it and he says, man, the lot is great. He said, but you're wasting time with this house. He said, tear it down and rebuild it.
Yes.
So for us, when we just kind of looked at the structure of the land was fertile and the lot was great, but just the building, the structure needed to be torn down and rebuilt from the foundation up.
Yeah.
And that was just always kind of just the vision that, you know, we would kind of make jokes year one, year two. Okay, the foundation is set. All right, now we're putting up a wall.
Yeah.
You know, let's get the roof going. Yeah. You know, and I remember, I think it was Coach Williams one year. She's like, you know, well, when are we going to be able to get a lamp? You know, she's like, when are we going to be able to decorate? When is the paint? When is, you know. Yeah. But, you know, it was a process just like building a house. And I just think that, you know, understanding that once the structure in the house was built, the land's going to be able to sustain
it. Yes, it will. So we found out that there was just a lot of potential and growth coming up. So we got here and, you know, dealt the hand that we had. And am I telling you, those kids that we had were athletic and phenomenal as well.
I just remember when we first got here having so many people come up in the community saying, man, y'all just missed it. If y'all would have been here 6 months ago, because at that point, you know, we came in with 2017s, 18s, 19s, and then we had 120 on varsity as a freshman. We had AJ.
So many
of those kids, you know, they were like, oh man, the best 17s went here. The best 18s went here.
Yeah.
You've lost all the 19s. All the good 19s, you know, are gone. But there was one key kid that we always talked about, and that was Bria Patterson.
Right. And let me tell the story about AJ real quick, and don't lose your thought. But I remember when I got here, kids, because of the coaching change, kids were transferring everywhere that we were losing them. And I went over to the middle school, and I remember telling you about AJ, AJ Thompson. And I said, Coach, we got to have this kid. We have to. So I think immediately got on the phone, talked with mom. And I remember, I mean, at that point, we were like, whatever we got to do. And I just remember having to pick AJ up some, and I would put her in my car and take her from the middle school to the high school so she could come up to the high school. And I don't know if she was running some open gym or what, but I do remember tagging Asia Thompson as one of those ones. Man, we have to make sure we keep this kid here.
Okay. I got your rebound right here. You smart. Now go get it. You know, hashtag new era. When I hear that, I feel like it was just a good platform that we settled. You know, I want to say Bria, she had good leadership. Most people don't like really say that, but like I've been there with her and we've been through fire and back, you know. So yeah. What we let out for the culture is like basically just be hungry, you know, it's y'all time. You just gotta go out there and kick butt. What I want people to do like in the future, you know, just win. Like we have a big name on our back now. We have a big target.
I remember watching Bria Patterson before we even knew this job, or did we know the job was open when we watched?
It wasn't. We were at a tournament. So BBW, we watched DeSoto.
Yeah, we were watching DeSoto, and once again, we were sitting there. It was like, yeah, there's DeSoto, all this talent. They're playing, and I remember one kid stood out of everybody on that floor that day I was watching that tournament. I think, was she number five?
Number five, yep.
And I said, Coach, you see that kid right there? I didn't know she was Bria Patterson. I said, man, that kid right there is so athletic. She can be amazing. I said, imagine what she would look like in a diamond.
Yeah.
Just putting her in a 12 press. And so I just remember talking about Bria maybe a year or two before we even got here. I was so impressed with her athleticism. Never thought in a million years that we would coach her.
Yeah.
Never could have imagined that.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, BP definitely was the anchor and the beginning.
So what makes a DeSoto Eagle player is toughness. We are really tough, you know, and people on the outside looking in, you might not think so, but we've been through so much that no one would even know of, and that just makes us who we are. We're so tough, mentally, physically, everything. So I think that's what, we are tough, gritty kids.
Well, we started it probably, I want to say probably around about 2010, somewhere in there. T.Y., Taylor Young, and some other kids were talking about, you know, how many kids we put out into college and everything. And, you know, the University of Miami puts out a lot of kids into the NFL.
Pay attention. Did you cost your group right now? Because you didn't pay attention. You gotta pay attention. Go!
And so we put out a lot of kids in college as well as the NFL. So we started calling ourselves the DeSoto U. So it flew from football to all the other sports. And, you know, it's just been like wildfire ever since then. And now, you know, you have all the sports that have bought into it. And the culture around here is, you know, you come here to DeSoto, you're gonna pretty much get a scholarship. And you're gonna go to college, and sometimes you make it to the pros, sometimes you're not, but it's about getting scholarships and going to college and winning championships around here.
Never really thought I would get the opportunity to be here. And, you know, I moved on, I was at Dengar High School, and the opportunity came where this head job came available. And I felt like it was a moment for me to kind of get to a place where I've always wanted to be. And took that opportunity, and I'm here. And when we got here, it wasn't the same place that I was watching from afar when I was younger. Some of the talent had dropped off. It was shifting a little bit. Culturally, it shifted. And it wasn't the same place that I saw. And so I grabbed up Coach Creel, and when I did get the job offer, I asked her to come with me, and we decided that we wanted to come here. And we knew that this place had never won a championship before, and we could never really figure out why. It's always had rich talent, always had the ability to just be great. I always felt like DeSoto could be one of the greatest places in the state, and I would even put it up nationally.
I am an AAU basketball coach. I have been an AAU basketball coach, and I watch these girls grow up. And we actually had, I coached the DC Queens, and Kayla, of course, played on my team. Kendall Brown played with me, and Ariana Hines. They played with me since the second grade, third grade, I think, through the ninth, 10th grade.
Presently, I have Samaya Smith, Michelle Yatewood, Jaya Perry. Oh, my bad, and Michelle Gatewood. And Jamia Harris, Tiana Herring, and over the years, it's been Mina Muhammad and Ayana Thompson. I think AAU is the best grassroots circuit there is. I got into it originally, I started with boys, and my daughter was a dancer, and I tried to put her in dance, but she wanted to play basketball. So put her on the team. They didn't have a coach. I decided to coach them. Then we got in the OCBF Church League, started playing basketball, found out about AAU Nationals. We were killing everybody in church ball, so we was like, okay, let's go to Florida and see how good we really are. Went down there, got our butts kicked, and was like, okay, there's some girls in the country that can really play basketball. Before they got here, I mean, leaving was the thing to do. You know, not a lot of kids stayed. I mean, well, elite kids, let me say that, just stayed. We saw them going further in the playoffs every year, so you kind of knew, okay, this thing's turned around. And we wanted to be part of that. And not only that, just the DeSoto not ever winning it, you know, why go somewhere else and be somewhere that have been there and done that? You know, I know for me and my kid, we want to be the first at everything. So we want to be the first. We want our picture up there with the boys.
The district that we're in is the toughest district in Texas. You know, we have Cedar Hill down the street. You know, every time we play them, it's a lot going on. It's loud. You know, even if it's not that many people compared to, you know, years ago because of COVID, it's still loud. So they bring a lot of pressure and a lot of intensity as a group. So that's a big game for us.
So if I had to brand this team this year, I would say toughness. That, like, you know, and I've been saying this all year, you know, with this group, they had every opportunity to make an excuse. We've came across every challenge, every adversity you could think of, and they had every moment where they could make an excuse and bow out, and they didn't. And they just had a level of mental toughness that's very hard to describe. You know, in all my years of coaching, I have to say this is the toughest teams I've had, and I have to say that their mental toughness is like no other.
The things I like about my team, they are hardworking. They work extremely hard, we all do. Even on days that some of us don't feel like it, we all push each other. It's the bond that I think we have. We all push each other because we all want what's best for each other, you know? It's just like, I want to be great, you want to be great, so let's go. We got to go be great together.
At practice, we work very hard, like sweat. Like, we'll sometimes come in two a day to get some stuff that we didn't finish in the first practice. Yeah, we get in the gym hard.
A song that comes to mind to describe this team is All I Do Is Win, because that's literally all we did this season, just kept taking dubs.
We had games back-to-back in the playoffs. Like, we played, I think it was Thursday, and then we played Friday, beat that, came over that. It's just ready for anything. Anything y'all try to throw our way, I'm pretty sure we overcome it.
My favorite things about this team is we're like a family. Like, there's no jealousy or nothing in the air. We hang out on and off the court. We do everything together. We really don't have that many friends outside the team. We bond a lot, so it's easier on the court.
You know, after a couple players got hurt, we had other players that stepped up into the role and did good in the role.
Stepping up to the role when we lost players, like big players, like in big games when we had to sit some people down, or then when people got hurt, step up, and then you had to get it done. So
this season, the journey all the way to the state was different. It was very different. We had to just keep focused on the end goal and what we wanted, which was to win state, and we just had to stay the course and keep the faith.
I describe this team as resilient. Because this team is like really hard to break throughout the ups and downs, the injuries, adversity. We still pushed through and ended up getting what our goal was.
The bond is definitely strong. I think it takes a really big part of how we play on the court together. We know each other like the back of our hands. And we're just like family, sisters.
Welcome to this District 11 6A matchup. The defending state champions, Duncanville, are here visiting the DeSoto Lady Eagles.
Definitely a lot of tension, you know, just from the warm-ups, you know, all the people there, the media there. So it was definitely tension, just knowing that this is a big game. There was a lot of tension on us. You could tell everybody was a little nervous, you know, us and Duncanville, because it was a big game. So everybody, you know, turned the ball over or just simple mistakes, just because the game was, it was such a big game going into it.
But yeah, so I wasn't at the game due to COVID contact tracing. So I had to kind of stay out due to the contact tracing issues. So that was really hard and difficult. Not being at one of the biggest games of the year was extremely tough. But I mean, there was no doubt that they were left in great hands. Coach Krill could handle it. There was no issues with that.
First quarter, you know, we played. It was pretty fast, you know, the whole game was a fast game to play in, so it was very intense. Then Jamia got hurt that first quarter, and it was just like, it's more pressure, because at that time she was our leading scorer, so now we're without. When she went, I remember she shot a layup, and I was right there when she fell, and she was like, I can't get up, and I was like, Jimmy, I was trying to be patient with her, you know. Somebody's talking about some, get up. I'm like, no, just let her take her time. Just over the course of the game, you know, just different individuals. It wasn't even her, like, the whole game, but just different individuals, you know, like, taking, like, jabs at my stomach, you know, while I'm running, you know, just little stuff like that, you know. It was just getting under my skin, you know. Usually I'm good at, you know, making sure, you know, I'm keeping my composure. That's what I'm known for on the team, is having good composure and keeping my cool. But this game, I just felt like it was just so much tension in that one area.
But watching that fight online was pretty tough. And so I have no idea what that was like live in a game of that magnitude, with losing, which I call her twin, I saw that, which was extremely devastating, because the minute I saw twin go up, I kind of already knew. And then later on in the game, you see another starter get into a fight. And so it was, I'm thinking, what else can we possibly go through? What else could happen to Coach Krill?
I didn't know this until Coach Robinson came back from her COVID protocol, when she told me. You know, when she came back, she said she was, I think that's right when it hit me, when Coach Robinson said she was disappointed in me. I was like, that's when it hit for real. Like, I really did something crazy, like, that wasn't me. Basically, you know, being out for so long, seeing my teammates play, couldn't even go to the games, like, watching them online. It gave me a different perspective of how to look at the game, like, not taking it for granted. You know, I'm sitting at home, they playing, so that was a big deal for me.
I really enjoy seeing them play down the stretch, because teams are trying to throw adversity at them, but even though they're young, they had 3 years of this. So it's like, oh, we down 11? Okay, we're gonna win by 20. And no one in the arena can understand that, but the fans who've been on that ride with them and the players on the court and the coaching staff.
To be a championship team, it's you have to make a lot of sacrifices. You have to put down social media, put down some friends, some family members, some talk in your ear, just block out a lot of stuff. It's a lot of hard work that comes with it, practicing every day, no off days.
They overcame a lot of injuries, and that's something that sometimes you can't overcome. But when you're able to overcome your injuries and have great leadership the way they did, you're able to do that right there.
The playoff run was very different to me because we had a couple of back-to-back games. You know, that's not really normal in the playoffs. But since Corona and, you know, we had to play a couple back-to-back games, so that was the difference.
So, by that time, it's like 10 o'clock.
Yeah, it's 10 o'clock at night. We're 45 minutes from the school. You know, we're right. Not at DeSoto. So we lose the flip, and we find out we are playing the next day. So then it's okay, got to start executing this plan. And it was having to tell the kids, hey, y'all got an hour to go home, shower, pack a bag, get back up here. We're getting on a bus, and we're heading to Austin tonight.
For me, if she called and said, hey, we need to go to Georgetown tonight, get ready for a game, they're going to make us play back-to-back. Well, let's see how comfortable we can make you, and let's see how we can get some things set up, because it's going to be hard on them to turn around, get in late, and play another game.
Welcome to this District 11-6A matchup. Duncanville has lost the first two meetings. Is the third going to be the charm for this team? Brings the ball down the court. Muhammad is fighting down in the paint. She puts it up. She got it. Muhammad is such a tough player. Robinson seems to be drawing up the right plays here tonight.
It was games. I rolled my ankle in the Duncanville game. I caught cramps in both of my calves that game.
Kendall Brown with a steal. Oh, lays it up. It's good. And one.
I knew I was gonna finish that game because I wanted to win. I wanted to continue and get back to state.
Welcome back. We are live here at the Alamo Dome in San Antonio, Texas for the 6A girls title.
Going into the game, our mindset was just shut down the two McDonald's All-Americans, and
make their other teammates play. And I think we did just that, but the first quarter to the second quarter, I wasn't rebounding like I know I should have. We weren't rebounding. So we know we had to give them one shot, get back on the boards and do what we needed to do.
Being down, we had been there before, and it was just like something, I think all of us, we had come to an understanding, was like, we can't do this again because of what happened freshman year. We was like, we need to fix this and we need to step up and come on.
You know, I'm thinking, man, there's two McDonald All-Americans, they're seniors, and I know 2019 we're down here with that senior, and I wonder if they're, you know, the will of the senior to come through. Luckily, they didn't know we had playoff Kendall.
I was praying to God. I was like, something gotta change. But I was nervous at the time, but I knew that eventually we was gonna get it together and rise above.
Hines with a three. It's good. Cook it up when
I write it down. I just had a mentality basically doing whatever it took to, like, I wanted a state championship. I didn't even care if I scored 20. As long as I was doing what I needed to do to make sure that we won that game, I was gonna do it.
Heron is playing a solid game tonight. Jaya Perry puts it up. It's good. Perry continues to come off the bench and give this team the spark it needs. Hines with another three, and it's good. She's brought this team back.
My first shot, it was a relief. I was just like, okay, one down. I can get more now. Like, now I'm on a roll.
It was the first time that I looked over, and we're still losing by 8. But it was one of those deals in my head where I felt confident in what we had done over the past 6 months in preparation for this moment, that the second half pretty much went about the way that I thought it was going to go.
Once they start coming back, I just knew we had it. And like, it was like start of the third quarter, I was already finna cry. It was like, I just know we was gonna win. So I was like, it was crazy, unbelievable.
Watch me take this to the match. This DeSoto team is soaring back into this game. Hey, Kendall back. Brown is on fire tonight.
And I had the and-one like right before halftime, and you know, it got us the lead. So we just kept building off that lead and using that momentum, and we just took off from there.
Big 10-0 run from DeSoto as they went into the half. This doesn't look like the same team we saw in the first quarter. Like, Mohammed is such a tough player. There's no stopping this team. They're on a roll. Who got negative feedback? Batman, you're wrong with a ski mask. I'm good in the hood, that's a G pass. I don't look back, I don't recap. You say you're the best, I don't see that. I lost some friends that I need back. There's nothing this team can do to stop DeSoto's bigs. On the way to be a favorite. On the way to see the
Lakers. Never got robbed by the majors. Used to get robbed by the neighbors. Then got, I really want to make this what, clear. Yeah, 10-second countdown. You know the bench was hype. I was definitely hype.
In my heart, I wanted them to win it and to celebrate and to enjoy it. And so when they were, and when that clock was ticking down, and I knew the game was over with, I just sat there and I watched our girls celebrate because it's something they had worked so hard for, but it's so hard to get.
The DeSoto Lady Eagles are the 6A state champions. Congratulations, Lady Eagles.
I think a few of the words that come to mind when I think about this Lady Eagle team, and one word is just courage. our kids are the most courageous kids that I know. During this time when COVID-19 has impacted the whole world and our community especially, our kids were fearless. They came to practice every day that they had practice. They competed on the floor when everyone was trying to retreat and go back home. They stood for what they believed in. They trusted, they had faith in their coaches. And they didn't give up. So they're resilient, they're courageous. They were doing things that even I was not doing. I have not played basketball in over a year now, but our Lady Eagles have won all but two games and brought home a state title in spite of a chaotic situation in our world.
When the horn went off, you know, I have to say it didn't even feel real. I stood there for a moment, I just kind of looked at the clock. It did not feel real. And then when I came to myself and like, we just won the 6A state championship. We just made history because that is what everybody was here for. It was just surreal.
And I think that one of the things to keep in mind when we talk about overcoming challenges and overcoming and just leading leaders, right? The teachers, the coaches, like they are leading young up and coming leaders in these student athletes. And when you're leading them, it's all about mindset. And one of the things that I observed when we talk about leadership that is guiding these student athletes, it was all about helping them change their mindset and have the mindset of a winner no matter what. Like helping them be prepared for the real world. Like when they step outside of those doors, they go to college or military or wherever their next steps may take them. It was all about mindset and equipping them for what is to come because challenges aren't gonna stop coming.
My hope for this team and my message for this team will be to just continue to soar in every area of your life. To take these lessons that you learn in basketball and apply them to life. When you get knocked down, get back up. When you didn't make the shot, okay, I didn't make the shot, so how can I readjust so that I can make the shot? And so I would just say to continue to soar, continue to learn the lessons that you've learned, because it's the lessons that you learn will build you for who you're supposed to become. It's character building.
This has been a year for me. My wife said, what do you do for next year? I'm not sure. My boys are doing well academically. I won principal of the year for the state of Texas. And the girls who first said, you are our principal and we're glad you're here, won a state championship. I'm not sure what you or how you follow that up. This has been awesome.
Some of my sentiments, first of all, I'm just so proud of them, you know, because I've been able to see the maturation throughout the years. I've been able to watch it. I've seen the culture from the outside, from when my daughter started, and I've also watched the evolution throughout her high school career. And there were some bumpy times here or there, but overall, when you get to the end of the tunnel, the number of people that have an opportunity to actually say that we are state champions, there's not that many people in the world that can turn around and say that they were state champions.
So this championship means everything to the city. I mean, to be able to, again, have this positive event to happen in our community, and again, not only to be able to highlight who these young women are as athletes, but I think it's more important to note who these young women are as scholars. One of the players, Ms. Kayla Glover, she's gonna be the salutatorian this year. I mean, it's just, there's so much that I could say about that, but it just shows that we here in DeSoto, we not only make champions on the court, but we also make champions in the classroom, and that's so important for our city.
You know, if I'm being honest, my first feeling for the kids, and I don't always feel that way because I'm real, you know, it's hard to satisfy me because I'm always looking for greater and even, I guess for me, I'm always looking for more. And so I'm never satisfied. And I want to say after that game, and you know, the kids may never know that, but I am so proud of those kids. I want to say that's my first emotion. Just proud of them. Because I've seen it and I've done it for a long time, and I know what they've been through and I know what we've been through, and the fact that they just didn't quit.
Do you have anything to say for the game?
The one that be yelling?
Any words of wisdom?
Words of wisdom. Go out, play hard, play strong, play DeSoto basketball. It's our time.
The JV coach.